The next item on the order paper is a motion on illegal drugs. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. One amendment has been selected and is published on the Marshall list. The proposer will have 10 minutes to propose and the amendment and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly acknowledges with grave concern the impact and extent of drug-related incidents, crimes and fatalities in our communities, supports the ongoing work carried out by statutory services, the Public Health Agency and the voluntary and community sector, and calls on the Minister of Justice to work alongside the relevant bodies to bring forward further measures to raise awareness and to ensure that the criminal justice system is tough enough to deal robustly with those who are responsible for the menace of drugs on our streets.
I call Mr. Paul Frew to move the motion.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And as I rise, this is my first opportunity to congratulate you in your appointment as the Speaker. I know you'll do a very, very grand job and bring with it all the fairness as the previous speakers have. So I thank you. I know you very well, Mr. Speaker. You've been a good friend to me, and I know that you'll lead this House in a very fair manner. So thank you. Can I also take this opportunity to congratulate the newly appointed Minister in her role as Justice Minister. And I know this is the first opportunity we've had to debate and engage with each other. Whilst I'm speaking here as an MLA for North Antrim, I happen to be also Justice Chairperson. And I can assure the Minister that that committee will fully scrutinise the work that she and her department do. But also we're here to, as a committee, to give advice and support in the coming months and years. So I congratulate the Minister in her new post. And I know it will be very exciting times for us all as we go forward. This is a very important debate. This is why we have brought it to the House of this chamber now, very quickly, into the new mandate, because we realise at first hand the devastation that drugs plays within our society, not only to the people who suffer addictions around drugs, but their families, their mothers, their fathers, their sons, their daughters, their wives and their husbands. And everyone in the wider family circle suffer when someone becomes addicted to drugs. And of course, the main frame of the motion, and can I just say that I know that there's an amendment down, and we are fully supportive of the amendment also. We realise very clearly that this is a holistic approach. Not one minister can solve this issue, this crisis within society. This crisis that hits a family hard, but it has to be a holistic approach. So we're very clear and gracious when it comes to the amendment, and we will be supporting the amendment. But as the main frame of the motion states, we want to see a criminal justice system that is tough enough to deal robustly with those who are responsible for the menace of drugs on our streets. Now, we're not simply talking, we're not just talking about drug users. We realise that it's against the law, we realise that you shouldn't take drugs, but we also realise that people are addicted. We also realise that it becomes an illness. We also realise that it takes over your life and it destroys the family within. We want to see, and we're not necessarily saying either the drug mules or the drug carriers, of course, they are breaking the law. They are breaking the law, and they need to be served justice as anyone else. But we really need to see a day when we tackle the ones at the very top, the ones who organise bringing shipments of drugs into these shores, the people who are organised enough, whether it be paramilitary or whether it be organised crime, it's much the same. We need to tackle those people. We need to get those people off our streets. Because when we get those people off our streets, there'll be no need for drug mules or carriers, and it will help us all, and especially help the drug addict as they try and adjust their life away from drugs, because without that, it cannot happen. But we also can't do the same thing over and over and over again. Drugs are here. Drugs are real. Drugs are everywhere. I would bet that there's not an establishment in this country that hasn't had a trace of drugs at some time or another within their premises. I would suggest that every note you have in your wallet or your purse would have traces also. This is how endemic this issue is to our society, and it is very important that we tackle it in a smart, tough way. And it is very important that the Minister gets to grips with some of the work that the Justice Committee done in the previous session and mandate around drugs courts and innovation going forward. Using courts smarter, being more clever when it comes to tackling the issue and making sure that people are removed from society, but then also that people aren't just thrown into prison, because you can be rest assured those people will come out with a drug problem. And that's something that we have to tackle also actually within our prisons. But if you look, if we simply are saying here today, and we're not, but if you're simply saying here today that we should throw everybody into prison with regards to drugs, it will cost every single one of us a lot of money. There are surveys that say it takes about 73,000 to keep someone in prison in Northern Ireland. It's a year. Some people would say it's even more than that, even £16,000 more, according to the prison inspectors, with regards to cost per occupied place. So we have to get smart, we have to get clever of how we tackle this. Because even if we do throw people into prison, drugs are still here. People will still find addictions. People will still have to go through treatment, and people will have to be tackled. Families will have to be supported, and that will all cost money also. But how wide-ranging is drugs? Wide-ranging, drugs doesn't just affect drug crime. I would hazard a guess that violence against the person, theft, burglary, robbery, criminal damage, public order or disorder, miscellaneous crimes against society, even some motoring offences and some sexual offences are caused because of drugs and because of the spectre of drugs. So how do we become smarter? And I'd appeal to the Minister, please, Minister, the first opportunity you get, please come down and visit the Railway Street Addiction Unit in Ballymena to see the real work that's being done to help drug users, supporting them, trying to get them off the habit, supporting the families, supporting the youngsters, supporting the mothers and the fathers to assist in trying to move people away from addiction, or at least help them suffer until they get to a point where they can reduce that addiction. It is vitally important that places like the Railway Street Addiction Unit are supported. And Minister, you're only in post, but your previous minister and the department were prepared to reduce funding for that service only last year. And only with a massive campaign in the community that fought hard to retain it was there a promise of 2 further years' support. Now, DOJ runs that facility in partnership with the Health Minister, and that's why it's important that we have a joined-up approach here. But 2/3 of that funding should come from DOJ. But there has been a reduced service since last year. And I would appeal to the Minister to please look at the Railway Street Addiction Unit in Ballymena and to look at moving that right across this province. Because those are the experts, those are the people who handhold these victims and these drug addicts. These are the people who support their families when times are tough. Times when we can't do it, we don't have the time. GPs certainly don't have the time, although they could do more. This is a specialised unit that deals with people even walking off the street. And think of the time and the chaos that would be caused with that even happening. Off the street, these people bring them in. They cater for their needs. They help them with all sorts of issues and dramas that the GPs and constituency offices, MLAs, constituency offices, citizens' advice cannot cope with, because they're medically trained in some respects. And even if it's something like needle exchange, something, even if it's to keep a drug addict or drug user safer in his practice, well, those are things that we need to strive to gain. Because if we make the drug user safer, we make his family or her family safer. And those are very, very important points, Minister. I would ask you, through the Chair, through the Speaker, to take away with you and to make sure you not only restore the funding needed and required to run addiction services and units throughout this province, but to enhance the funding for those areas and those specialisms. Not only to enhance, but to spread them out so that more people from across this province can cater and get help when they are needed. Yes, I will. Yes, I will.
I thought they're supposed to be collective government decision-making. Can you advise me if you, in approving the budget, have put sufficient funds so that the Minister for Justice can continue to fund this very worthwhile work, or, having appointed her, are you now starting to criticise her because she doesn't have enough funds to carry out her work? Is there a collective responsibility or not?
I remind the member that your time is almost up. You don't get an extra
minute. Oh. Okay.
Your time is up.
Mr. Speaker, well...
Your time is okay. Up. Before I call Ms. Nicola Mullen to move the amendment, this is her first opportunity to speak in the chamber, and as is the convention of the chamber, she's usually allowed to speak without introduction. That is, of course, if she follows the normal procedure of the chamber. Otherwise, she may provoke some interruptions. I call Ms. Nicola Mullen.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise to move this amendment and, in doing so, as you point out, make my main speech to this House on what is certainly an issue of grave concern to my constituents in North Belfast. The well-documented prevalence and escalation of drugs misuse through both the consumption of illegal drugs and prescribed medicines is having a devastating impact on individuals, families and our community. It is a growing problem. I know my predecessor, Alban McGuinness, a gentleman who dedicated decades of his life to trying to improve the quality of life of the people of North Belfast, was acutely conscious of and committed to tackling. Having witnessed in North Belfast the torment of individuals falling victim to drug addiction and the anguish and heartache felt by their families struggling to help free them from the cruel and debilitating grip of this addiction. As a councillor in North Belfast over the past 6 years, it is a heartbreaking situation I have also witnessed far too many times. And I share Alban McGuinness's passion and determination to do what I can in this new role to prevent other individuals of all ages and their families having to go through the painful battle with drug addiction and the mental anguish that goes hand in hand, which, in the worst cases, Mr. Speaker, ends in a family forever mourning their loved one. It is for this reason that my party colleague Colin McGrath and I tabled this amendment on behalf of the SDLP. Before I move on to specifically address the amendment, I would like to firstly commend the DUP for bringing a motion on illegal drugs before us on the first day of business for this new Assembly. The priority they have given to this issue in bringing it forward today demonstrates a commitment, I believe, to tackle this growing epidemic on our streets. I can assure them that even though we may sit on opposite sides of this House, this is a priority issue for the SDLP and a commitment that we share, as I'm sure other parties in this House do. Certainly, as the original motion points out, the Minister for Justice has a key role to play. The SDLP welcomes the increase in recent years in the number of drug seizure incidents and drug-related convictions. We also welcome the recent strengthening of legislation in respect of the supply of psychoactive drugs. We believe, however, that much more needs to be done by the PSNI and the Department of Justice working with communities if we are to seriously tackle the proliferation of drugs on our streets. We also believe that this issue cannot be tackled by focusing on the supply side alone. If we are to be robust in tackling the scourge of illegal drugs and the misuse of prescription drugs for that matter, the job is not one solely for the Minister of Justice. It is a much wider job for the Executive, with critical input and collaboration between the Justice Minister and the Ministers for Education and Health in particular, who have an instrumental part to play in reducing demand by educating young people in particular against the dangers of drugs to prevent experimentation in the first instance, and critically, delivering increased provision of, access to, and awareness of early intervention and support services when the symptoms of drug taking first present, and when the chances of breaking the dangerous and harmful downward spiral that ends in addiction are highest. It is for these reasons, Mr. Speaker, that we are seeking to expand the responsibility and remit of the original motion with our amendment, and I welcome the DUP's indication of support. I want at this point to put on record my appreciation for the tremendous life-changing and, in many cases, life-saving work which is carried out by those working in addiction and mental health services in the statutory, voluntary and community sectors in North Belfast, but also in constituencies right across Northern Ireland. They are working under immense pressure, with an increase in demand for their services, particularly in services required by children and young people, as referrals for the Child and Adolescent Mental Health Service and Drug and Alcohol Mental Health Service issue. And they are trying to respond to this increase in demand at a time when budgets are being put under pressure. They rightly should be praised for their commitment and dedication to helping some of the most vulnerable in our society. And they should be supported to expand their collaborative work and intensive intervention, and that is what this amendment is calling for. These organisations will tell you, and all of the evidence shows, Mr. Speaker, that prevention and early intensive support in the community works. It's about the right medication, the right support at the right time. This is critical if we are to prevent the spiral of physical and mental harm and other harmful behaviours that can follow to fund a habit when someone becomes hooked on drugs. While we may not have total precise figures, we do know that drugs misuse brings with it an immense cost, not least to our health service, our economy and our justice system. The human cost, however, the months, the years of a life spent battling an addiction, and the mental vulnerability that accompanies such an addiction, the many families left broken by a battle with this cruel addiction, and the lives of all the loved ones lost as a result of drugs can never be truly or fully captured. It is, however, possible to get a sharp and startling insight into the human cost and misery when you spend time listening to individuals and families who have come through this journey, and perhaps most acutely, when you listen to those families who have painfully lost a loved one caught up in what is a growing epidemic. Though the individual sets of circumstances may vary, Mr. Speaker, the one thing that I find unifying the individuals and families affected that I have spoken to is their response when I ask them, in their opinion, what more can be done. Almost always, it is the same answer. Ensure that more help is made available and accessible earlier, before the full grip of addiction takes its hold and mental health and well-being deteriorates to a level that is incredibly difficult to come back from, especially for a young person who in their formative years is only beginning to find themselves. I acknowledge, Mr. Speaker, phase two of the new strategic direction for alcohol and drugs and its key elements, one of which includes a focus on prevention and early intervention. But families who have been affected and those families currently living with the horror of drugs misuse, especially when it involves a child, feel desperately that much more needs to be done. It is in response to these testimonies that we have brought forward this amendment. As I bring my contribution to a conclusion, Mr. Speaker, I want to make reference to one of the many powerful testimonies shared with me over recent times. It is a message from Aaron Fox, who, while he had bravely and successfully battled his addiction, sadly lost his life just a few short months ago in a courageous battle with the resulting mental demons that proved just too much to bear. Aaron's story was relayed to me by his devoted father and mother. Aaron, a budding chef and talented artist, was determined to use his gifts, particularly through his recovery, to share his very personal experiences with other young people to prevent and protect them from going through what he had. He powerfully, through his creative gifts, wanted to show the true picture, the real torment that in this instance legal highs unleashed on a young person and their loved ones. Since his painful passion or passing, and even through their grief, his parents are determined to carry on Aaron's message, warning other young people and campaigning to ensure that help is available as early as possible to young people in particular, so that they do not become trapped by their addiction and, critically, the mental anguish that ensues. I felt, Mr. Speaker, that it was important today, with the consent of Aaron's parents, to pass on his message and the call from his parents for more help at an earlier stage, a call that is echoed in so many homes and by so many people who have and are going through the nightmare of this experience. There is a duty on us all to listen to these families and to act, and therefore I hope this amendment secures the support of all parties in this House. Thank you.
Call Ms. Michaela Boyle.
I rise to support the motion and the amendment, and I also want to take the opportunity to congratulate you, Mr. Speaker, in your role, and also to welcome the Minister and wish her well in her new role. We are all aware of the dangers of the use of illegal drugs and the scourge on society that they have and the severe consequences that can lead to death with those using illegal drugs. Many during this debate will talk about illegal drugs. However, we need to include alcohol and the fact that we have so many young people who are drinking and taking drugs at a very early age, because alcohol use is legal, but it does play a strong role in relationship to crime. Driving while intoxicated and using drugs, and also drug and alcohol-related domestic violence and rape, all of these crimes have seen a rise, and we know that they can also cause death and injury. We also need to look at further investment into the solution, not just the problem, and we've talked about early intervention and awareness. That is key. And indeed, for those who are already sentenced and are in prison for drug-related crime, they too need the help. They need the help in prison, proper help, not more drugs, as we all too are aware that drugs are easily accessible in some of our prisons. Treatment saves money in the long term, so early intervention is key. Mr. Speaker, in my own district council area of Strabane and District Council, recent figures released, PSNI figures released, state that the overall crime figures across our district have increased in the period from April 2015 to March 2016. And right across the north, the overall crime figure has risen from 103,000 to 105,000 in 2014-15. Whilst overall crime was up by less than 1%, burglary, robbery and theft offences saw significant decreases. But the point I want to make, within this slight increase in overall crime, the number of drug possessions recorded in my district council area was up by 5.8%. This does mean that more people are being detected in possession of drugs. Increases in arrests in this area have to be welcomed. However, tougher and tighter sentencing needs to be part of the solution and needs to follow those arrests. We need to do more collaborative working together between justice, the probation board and the statutory agencies to work better with communities to address illegal drugs and to provide, more importantly, assurances to the public that if they have the relevant information that they have and hold on who is responsible for bringing such illegal drugs into our areas, and they want to pass that information over to the proper authorities, that they can come forward without any fear or reprisal. The community planning within PSNI needs to be implemented with communities. The Policing and Community Safety Partnerships, the PCSPs, should be the vehicle for moving this issue forward within our communities, but they are only one cog in the wheel. The PSNI, DOJ and everyone else needs to be proactive and raising awareness. If there is effective agencies working together, this will promote positive outcomes for those in need and those that need to be safeguarded and protected from crime and illegal drugs. The efficiency of the criminal justice system has room for improvement, and the community and voluntary organisations need to be working together to implement strategies that have been set out in the Justice Act 2015 to bring about greater powers to bring cases to the High Court where those responsible for pushing drugs onto our street are caught and there are more prosecutions going through the courts. The public need to have confidence in our justice system, as we are hearing from far too many, many families. The one place that they relied and depended on to get justice was the very place that let them down, the courtroom. To conclude, Cancolia, the use of drugs and alcohol can negatively affect all aspects of a person's life. The impact on their family, friends and communities, if not addressed, place enormous financial burden on our health and justice departments. The relationship between drugs and crime is indeed a complex one, and one question is whether drug use leads people into criminal activity or whether those who use drugs are already predisposed to such activity. However, at the most intense levels of drug use, crime are directly and highly correlated, and serious drug use can lead to pre-existing criminal activity. I support the motion.
Call Mr. Doug Beattie.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Firstly, I would like to say that I fully support this motion by the TUP. It's a good motion, it's a timely motion, and I have to say that the SDLP's amendment gives it added teeth, so I also support that. As I listen to other contributors, and I will be reasonably brief because I can't but agree with them all so far, it is important that we do focus on prevention as opposed to waiting till we get the drug addict and trying to deal with that raw product. And I also agree with Nicola Mallam when she says this can't be just for the criminal justice system and the Justice Minister. This has got to involve the Communities Minister, it's got to involve the Education Minister, the Health Minister, and also the Finance Minister. And what we really need is a cross-ministry action plan to deal with this drugs issue. And I hope the Justice Minister can take that away and think about that for something for the future. There is a problem with illegal drugs in Northern Ireland and elsewhere, and that is the messaging that's going out, the social messaging that's going out, because it doesn't matter who we are, slightly older, slightly fatter people standing in this assembly, because you go to the under-18s or you go to the young men and they believe it's socially acceptable to take drugs, and some of the messages that are going out tell them that it's socially acceptable to take drugs. Some people are told that cannabis is not habit-forming, that it is not a gateway drug. And having worked and having trained and having lived with under 18-year-olds, I know how difficult it is to try and sell that very clear message that there should be a zero tolerance on drugs. I have seen firsthand what drugs can do to a society. I have stood in the cannabis fields in Asia and watched them be cultivated and watched them be sold. I see the pennies that the people who grow it get, and the real people who get the money are those who refine it and those who cut it and those who export it to us in the West. And there has to be an international response to drugs. One of the reasons why I genuinely believe it is better that we stay within the EU to try and tackle the drugs trade before it reaches our shores. And when it does reach our shores, it's important that the National Crime Agency take hold of the issue and try and stop it from getting onto our streets. But the bottom line is that the work of dealing with the drugs issue in Northern Ireland will lie with our communities, it will lie with our messaging, it will lie with our health service, our justice system, and it will lie with the PSNI. It's up to us to ensure that we facilitate them in dealing with this issue. Thank you.
Call Mr. Trevor Lunn.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Like everybody else, I think I approve of both the motion and the amendment. I prefer the wording of the amendment just in small detail, because for a start it refers to community and not communities. I'm sure Mr. Beattie didn't, that was a slip of the tongue. This is a cross-community problem. And also the amendment calls on the executive rather than the single minister to do something or try and coordinate this, and that's absolutely where it lies, because as others have said, this involves a multi-agency approach, public health, justice, communities, social services, particularly perhaps education and further education, because there's no doubt that drug problems are far more prevalent in areas of low educational achievement and economic inactivity. So the other thing I would say is that the motion is listed under illegal drugs. I think others have referred to it, that it's not just a question of illegal drugs. The Centre for Social Justice study back in 2011 indicated that perhaps the greater part of the problem is in fact the misuse of prescription drugs. So there's a job for education, for all agencies to become involved and try and wean people away from this sort of practice, which now appears to be socially acceptable in a way that perhaps we sort of certainly surprises our generation. You know, it never should have got to this point. The last two lines of both the motion and the amendment, what I really want to talk about, Mr. Speaker, and that's let me just read it again. The criminal justice system is tough enough to deal robustly with those who are responsible for the menace of drugs on our street. Like, does anybody here seriously doubt who is responsible for the supply and control of the trade in drugs on our streets? Because it is paramilitary groups. They can call themselves criminal gangs. Well, I can call them criminal gangs. But I fully appreciate that some of our ex-paramilitaries are now doing good work on the streets. I know some of them are doing that. In my opinion, most of them are not. They've just morphed from one type of inhuman organisation into another, and they're leeching on the back of our population and sections of our population most vulnerable and least able to handle the pressures that are coming onto them in this situation. And let's be frank, I'm talking about the UDA, the UVF and the IRA, or what's left of them, in different forms. Mr. Speaker, we need to stop treating criminals as upright citizens. It's as simple as that. And we need to stop giving them credibility and credence and the way perhaps that some of us try to work with them, in the way that perhaps the PSNI approach them. Now, I have assurance from the Chief Constable that if a member of a paramilitary organisation comes to the attention of the police with this sort of activity, they will be dealt with in a firm and robust manner in the terms of the amendment and the motion. But I still think that there's far too much cozying up between public agencies, politicians of all shades, and people who used to be paramilitaries, and in the opinion of some of us are still just exactly that. They're not only supplying the drugs, they're supplying the finance to enable youngsters to buy the drugs. And then they're pursuing them at extortionate interest rates because they can't pay for them. At the end of the day, what they'll get out of that is, if they can't pay, is a beating or worse. They're also, in terms of controlling the drugs trade, they're setting themselves up as judge and jury and pretending to keep order by dealing with drug dealers, or perhaps eliminating drug dealers, when all they're really doing is protecting their own interests, protecting their own turf. And if we talk about bringing a tougher justice system, I think that the criminal justice system as it stands is robust enough to deal with these situations. But we need the political will. We need to take away the credibility of these people to act in the way they do. And I hope that everybody will indicate a need for full political support for loosening paramilitary control, and the sooner the better. That's the only way. You've got to tackle the root of this, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I'm glad to see you there. And that's all I have to say about it, and it's a disgrace.
I call Lord Morrow. Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I want to say that I commend those who have brought this motion to this House this afternoon. I think, as others have said, it's a very timely motion, and it's one that I'm delighted to see that, in fact, the House finds itself in agreement with right round the benches, and also, of course, the amendment. Could I just say that today is the first response we will have from the new minister. I welcome her here in that capacity, and I wish her well in her new post. I think I'm doing more than some others have done in the past, but I certainly wish her well, and I have no doubt she will equip herself well to the task that she is going to perform over the weeks and months and hopefully years ahead of us. Mr. Deputy Speaker, in my constituency of Fermanagh South Tyrone, there are swathes of cases coming before the courts in some way rooted to as a result of illegal drugs. But I fear the message is still not getting through. I'm also somewhat shocked when I hear people play down the use of, for example, cannabis. We hear it was only a bit of cannabis, nothing heavy. Well, let me be absolutely clear today. In my opinion, any illegal drug, including cannabis, is a step on the road to addiction. It is known for good reasons as a gateway drug, and even taken on its own is no less toxic on mental health than any other substance. When it comes to illegal drugs, there is no such thing as nothing heavy. All have the potential and capacity to impact on the brain and other organs with often catastrophic, if not fatal, consequences. The task at hand is to educate people away from drugs in the first place, but enforcement of the law is also important in my books. My constituency has had far too many drug-related deaths over recent years. And it must be said, greater number of these are young people. Back in 2014, I supported the former coroner, John Leckie, when he called for a change in the law to allow dealers who sell drugs to be charged with manslaughter if a person dies after consuming them. Speaking at an inquest, John Leckie said, "To say I am not impressed is an understatement. Someone is dead here, and there are 19 other people dead from taking these drugs. Anyone who has information has a duty to come forward. It's a disgrace and it's on their conscience," he added. "I acknowledge the difficulties for the police to link evidence, but I urge the PPS to consider manslaughter very much to the fore in these instances. Anyone taking these pills is playing Russian roulette with their life. I hope this sends out a warning to young people. No guarantee comes with the drugs, and the risk of death is a high one." End of quote. The inquest in question was that of a teenager from Dungannon who died after taking a synthetic form of ecstasy. She was just 18 years of age. Despite the former coroner's concerned comments and amongst heartbreaking headlines, drugs continue to be a scourge in our society, and the attraction for them has not abated. The consequences continue to demonstrate the horror of illegal drugs. This myth that drug taking is an exciting game of chance must be dispelled. The cycle has to be broken and stronger efforts made to get the message home. Mr. Deputy Speaker, can I draw the attention of the House to a tremendous facility which exists in the Dungannon area called Breakthrough, who have been working on this problem for over 20 years. Now, during a meeting last year, I asked Breakthrough to come up with an alternative disposal scheme which would drive home the dangers of drugs and alcohol abuse, with awareness for potential victims of drug and alcohol-related crime. I am pleased to say that the initiative was embraced by Breakthrough and is very soon to be launched, with a pilot planned for the Mid-Ulster area. The scheme offers a drug, alcohol and antisocial referral scheme as an alternative to prosecution. However, it will only be offered once and must be fully completed. They have done a magnificent job and must continue to be supported by all relevant government agencies. Now, I won't say anything more about that because the stage is very much, this is their project, and I don't want to steal their thunder. However, I can confirm that the scheme links with the Department of Justice's business plan 2015-16 and is designed to meet departmental priorities and targets. I'm unashamedly proud to have breakthrough in Dungannon and commend them for the work that they're doing.
And
I would extend an invitation to the Minister to come to breakthrough in Dungannon. And if you've never been to Dungannon, Minister, your education is not complete, but I'm sure you'll do that one day. Thank you very much.
Dahi Mackay.
I got a last concurrent. Can I again congratulate you on your elevation and indeed congratulate the Minister on what's bound to be quite a challenging department to manage. I rise to support both the motion and the amendment. And of course, as most of it's already been covered, illegal drugs are absolutely everywhere. They've been everywhere since I was a child. When we went to school, if you wanted drugs, you could get them. And I'm sure if it was that bad then, how bad is it now? I dread to think. It's available in the workplace, on our streets, on our street corners, and most concerning of all, in our schools and in our playgrounds. And it has many secondary impacts. Violence on our streets. We've seen the violent gang crime in Dublin, which is all related to the illegal drug trade as well. And when you look at the statistics, they're quite interesting for 2015-16. 4,445 cannabis seizures, 566 cocaine seizures, 128 ecstasy, 138 opiates. So the vast, vast majority of seizures are related to the use and the addiction of cannabis, and quite low in terms of cocaine seizures, I think, as well, given that about 34% of those misused, and according to the figures in the PSNI report, relate to cocaine. So there is quite a significant amount of cannabis seizures compared to other Class A drugs. And I want to also pay tribute to the many services in Dungannon and Ballymena and elsewhere. I know I've worked for many years along with other constituency MLAs with the Hope Centre, who have worked tirelessly and have struggled year after year to scrape together funding to deal with those families that are affected and those that are suffering from addictions. And continuing funding for groups like these is absolutely vital in terms of addiction prevention. And many of us as well in Ballymena and in North Antrim and indeed beyond campaign to keep Railway Street open in Ballymena after the Department of Justice at that time withdrew £360,000. So that was a great success. And of course, all of these services are vital. I will, yeah.
I do really appreciate the House and the way and the manner in which they've conducted this debate, apart from one admission on that point. But the member's quite right in the community and the work that they do, the voluntary and public sector, community sector, and the Hope Centre, and the good work that they do. And although you're only talking about hundreds of thousands of pounds, the same as a railway street, hundreds of thousands of pounds, to do a service that can spend the money more effectively than any government agency. And that's a good way of spending your budget.
Member makes a very good point. And sometimes departments are very quick to jump to defend their own internal services, but put much less value on external services, service within the community on the ground, even though they're delivering best practice and sometimes better practice than the departments. So I think Mr. Beattie said that prevention is better than the cure, then we need to focus on prevention. I think that is key in this debate, and the railway street has been held up as a model of best practice in helping injecting drug users, and the impact has been absolutely huge, because many of those who were campaigning to keep the place open were the addicts themselves. He said, we would not be here if it was not for the service that is provided. So drugs clearly destroy lives, not only of those who are addicted to those substances, but also their families. And I agree with the chairperson of the Justice Committee, you can't just throw everyone with a drug addiction into prison. That simplistic approach hasn't worked. The various wars on drugs clearly have not worked. And at the end of the day, drug addiction is a health issue. Those who work in addictions and support groups across the north all say that the worst addiction cases are those relating to legal substances, mainly alcohol. That is a fact that Michaela Boyle also referred to. So we shouldn't just be focused on the illegal substances are the worst and the legal ones aren't so bad, because alcohol clearly is the worst substance that we have to deal with within our society. And the challenge for the Justice Minister and the Justice Committee and all of us as MLAs in terms of policy and drugs going forward, I think we need some fresh thinking. I think, according to these figures, drug seizures have doubled in the past 10 years, so whatever we're doing is not working. It's not working correctly. The drug misuse is increasing, so we need to focus on prevention. We should have less of a focus on the criminalisation of those who abuse, those who are addicted to substances. We should have more focus on those who are doing the dealing and making money on the backs of the misery of many families. But we do need some fresh thinking, and I know there is a lot of fresh thinking taking place across Europe in regard to this particular issue, and I think this is something that we really need to get to grips with in the new Assembly term.
Deputy Speaker, and can I wish you well in your new role, and also to wish the new Justice Minister well in her new role. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I welcome this opportunity to speak on this motion today. Drugs have a significant and widespread negative influence not only here in Northern Ireland but right across the globe. On top of this, drug abuse and the peddling of drugs in our local communities continues to put major pressures on our health service and on the PSNI. Many families have also been destroyed and left with grief that will never be resolved due to the scourge of drugs. We all must recognise that drugs continue to blight our communities despite the best efforts of the police and the community at large to tackle drug problems. For instance, it has been documented that between 2003 and 2012 there were 838 drug-related deaths in Northern Ireland. Notably, the number of drug seizures increased year on year, has increased year on year since 2006-07 to reach a 10-year high of approximately 5,600 such incidents in 2015-16. Whilst it could be claimed that this is welcome news to see an increased quantity of drugs being taken off our streets, it has also to be recognised that the drug problem has not gone away. In recent years, we have witnessed what is formally referred to as legal highs, presenting a never-growing challenge to our society. We have seen the Psychoactive Substance Act coming into force across the United Kingdom last month. And from a personal perspective, when I met the PSNI within my own constituency in recent times, they informed me that such substances pose more difficulty than the more traditional form of drugs on our streets. Even though such substances could previously be obtained legally, they still possessed a dangerous and sometimes deadly effect. Police now have new powers to shut down head shops and UK-based online dealers. Additionally, there now exists a UK-wide blanket ban on the sale, supply, importation and exportation of such drugs, with those who deal in such substances also facing up to 7 years imprisonment. Whilst legislation is not the silver bullet, Mr. Deputy Speaker, these new measures can hopefully help to tackle the problems that psychoactive substances pose. Tragically, in recent years, numerous people within my own constituency of Upper Ban have lost their lives because of drugs, and many families have been devastated. I have met the PSI locally on many occasions in which the scourge of drugs has been continually highlighted as a major challenge. Between the beginning of May 2015 to the end of April 2016, 391 drug-related incidents were reported to the PSNI within the Portadown, Banbridge, Guildford, Lurgan and Craigavon areas. Clearly, drug-related incidents are consuming a significant amount of police time, and I know that the PSNI in this area have done much work to fight the local drug problem. I am also concerned by the fact that in many cases members of the public are aware of the individuals who deal in drugs within our communities but are fearful of providing the police with such information due to fear of reprisals. On top of this, it is very worrying to note that drugs are being taken by a wide range of people, with some very young people getting caught up in drug-related activity. Unfortunately, the problems I have outlined are replicated right across Northern Ireland, and regrettably, there are no quick-fix solutions to eradicating the scourge of drugs overnight. Whilst it is important to recognise the ongoing work carried out by the statutory agencies, the public health agencies and the voluntary and community sector to tackle the drug scourge, it is important to recognise that drugs continue to damage communities and devastate families. It is vital that the community as a whole unite together to fight this drug plague head-on. In particular, the PSNI, local policing and community safety partnerships, schools, youth organisations, other community groups have a very important duty to challenge the problems drugs pose. Mr Deputy Speaker, moving forward, it is vital the PSNI's commitment to fighting against the challenge of illegal drugs continues, and as I have said, it should be a cooperative approach. And I would hope that this chamber here today takes on board what everyone has said, and that the message must go clearly out from this assembly that those who peddle drugs and inflict misery and pain on individuals and their families will not be tolerated. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. And I'd first like to declare an interest as a committee member of the Carrickfergus Community Drugs and Alcohol Advisory Group, which was previously involved in counselling and in drugs awareness and resilience training, but which is no longer operating due to funding issues. And can I congratulate the Minister on her appointment and wish her well in her post. But I have noticed already that those who have been involved in appointing her, certainly their parties, are already pressing on the budget that they set her, and I wonder if that is a sign of what is to come in the future. I hope not. I too rise to support the motion and the amendment, which I believe strengthens the motion. And I'd like to thank the Assembly Research Services for their useful background brief to this issue. The motion has been given the very short title of illegal drugs, but when you read the detail of the motion and indeed the amendment, the word legal or illegal is not mentioned. And in fact, many of the members who have already spoken here have referred to the difficulty with legally available drugs and the misuse of alcohol and other drugs. So to my mind, the issue covers both legal drugs and illegal drugs. There's the big issue of misuse of legally prescribed medicines, and as I've said earlier, the misuse of alcohol, which because of its availability and prevalence is one of the biggest issues when addictions occur. There's some interesting figures in the drug prevalence in Northern Ireland key facts for 2014-15, where they highlight that from the survey of those on the effects of taking drugs and alcohol in the last 12 months, some 35% taking alcohol regretted something that they said or did, 7% of those taking drugs. And then you go into a whole range of issues and you find that there's equal dangers with addiction or misuse of alcohol as there is with other drugs in terms of harms to individuals' health, harms to their friendships and social life, harms to home life or marriage, or whether they got into a fight or were involved in an accident. So we need to be clear that it's wider than just illegal drugs that difficulties can arise. The Department of Justice findings on the view of alcohol and drug-related issues emanating from the September 2015 Northern Ireland Omnibus Survey highlights an increasing level of concern for drugs-related issues in Northern Ireland. Of those surveyed on the level of drugs-related issues, some 13% felt things were getting worse, 5.2% felt they were getting better. And there seems to be a very particular problem in the Belfast Health Trust area, where 23.2% felt things were getting worse. In my own area, the Northern Health Trust, some 8.2% perceived a worsening in trends. So the Omnibus survey highlighted some areas of concerns. So in terms of the harms caused, almost 60% of people were concerned that antisocial behaviour resulted. There was damage to individuals' health, crime in the local area, some 13%. There's the issue of fear in their local area, and of course the issue of violence and some other issues. So this is clearly an area of concern. Turning to the amendment, I believe that it better highlights the need to invest in preventative work, as well as recognising the role of statutory services, the public health agency, and the community and voluntary sector. It talks of the need to increase awareness to create greater resilience and avoidance of addiction in the first place. That's key. From my previous experience, that is a very vital area. Early intervention services for children and young people and adults, again, is very important so that the addiction does not occur and young people are better informed of the dangers of alcohol and other drug misuse. So I would commend Nicola Mullen for highlighting this adverse effect, particularly in the area of mental health and well-being. Frequently, drug misuse and mental health and well-being issues are related, and it is important that they are highlighted. of course, for the real hard-nosed criminals who are profiting through this, it's vital to have a robust criminal justice system to deal with it. But I would like to also highlight the importance of preventative work and praise the work of PAL, Preventing Addiction Larne, within my own East Antrim constituency, a group of volunteers who've had to fundraise, get very little help from any statutory services, and that's an area I'd invite the Minister to take a look at, given her interest in community and voluntary sector in particular.
I call Mr George Robinson.
Yeah, Mr Deputy Speaker. Deputy Speaker, first and foremost, could I congratulate the new Justice Minister on her appointment and yourself as the new Deputy Speaker. Sadly, I speak in this debate shortly after a child's chocolate egg was found in Limavady with a packet of drugs hidden inside it. This is a reason that each and every one of us should be concerned about the scourge of illegal drugs in our society. When some depraved individuals considered it acceptable to hide drugs in children's sweets, it is obvious they have no regard for or value for human life. On this occasion, it was a five-year-old who discovered the egg contents, and thankfully an older sibling took it to their father, who informed the police in Limavady. The possibility for a fatality here was immense. The sad thing is that this is only one of many drugs found, such as a large cannabis find in a house in the centre of Limavady a few weeks ago. Mr Deputy Speaker, there are too many families who have lost loved ones to the scourge of drugs, so I believe it is essential that robust action is undertaken, where the court service will make an example for those who have been apprehended for drug dealing. Another drug death is one too many. I want to pay tribute to the many organisations who work to address the drug problems in Northern Ireland. There are many, and they all deserve credit, but I am aware of the excellent work done by community and voluntary groups, and I commend them specifically for the work that they do. The police are very proactive, and we can all read or hear of the drug seizures that they make. Mr Deputy Speaker, their problem is that every town, village and city has a drug problem, so it is very difficult for them to track down the suppliers, but somehow they manage to achieve many successes, and these successes save lives. This is where I would encourage the general public to report any suspicious activity to the police, where hopefully some of those drug dealers could be apprehended and taken off our streets. Mr Deputy Speaker, I can assure the Minister that she will have my full support and actions taken against the peddlers of death that are drug dealers. I can also assure her that I support an interdepartmental agency approach in raising awareness of drugs and ensuring tough punishments being handed down. Yes.
And he leads on a very, very important point with regards to departmental budgets and responses. But there is always this tendency, and it goes back to the point that I was going to make to Mr Beggs, Member for East Antrim earlier, I ran out of time, in that there's always a tendency with departments, no matter what department it is, to keep money in-house, to keep money in the centre. Whenever that 300,000 or that half a million could be spent far better and far greater ways by the voluntary and community sector, because they are the ones with the real specialism who have got the grips with these problems. You.
Mr Deputy Speaker, my colleague has made a very relevant point, which I support fully. I am therefore happy to support the motion. Thank you very much.
as we welcome the Justice Minister to the Chamber on this, her first appearance at the dispatch box, and we wish her well. I call the Minister of Justice, Ms Clare Sugden.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker, and I wish to congratulate you on your elevation. I'm actually really delighted for you, and I think you'll do a fantastic job. I very much welcome the opportunity to respond to my first private member's motion as Justice Minister of Northern Ireland on an issue that I know regrettably affects the lives of so many across this country, and that's drugs misuse. I congratulate the proponents of the motion for highlighting this important matter early in the new mandate, because I think with the support of this Assembly, and it seems that we have it, that the Executive has an opportunity to tackle this issue in an appropriate way towards best outcomes for the community, for our community and wider society. Whilst I appreciate this is a private member's motion, I note the members who have tabled this motion are members of the Justice Committee, including the Chairperson and Deputy Chairperson. I am keen to ensure a good working relationship with the committee to ensure proper scrutiny. In fact, I welcome all constructive criticism from all sides of this House, Deputy Speaker, because I want to make the right decisions, not just for myself, but for the people of Northern Ireland, and I think I can do that with the input of my colleagues in this chamber. This is why I am also congratulating the authors of the amendment. I believe the amendment takes the spirit of the original motion and provides a further considered perspective, strengthening the aim of this evening's debate. Mr. Deputy Speaker, we are all familiar with the impact on the health service of treating drug misuse. And regrettably, we all know the recent figures that tragically over 100 people die each year from drug-related causes. I cannot begin to imagine the impact that this has on families, on the community, and on the people who are in the grips of addiction. Mr. Robinson alluded to a recent drugs find in my own constituency and his in Limavady. It's disgusting, Deputy Speaker, and it's something that we do need to address. In terms of the general drugs picture, the main illegal drug used in Northern Ireland is cannabis. So I take Lord Morrow's point that cannabis shouldn't be underestimated. The fact that it's the main illegal drug in Northern Ireland in itself is quite worrying. Thankfully, we have seen a drop in the use of drugs among 11 to 16-year-olds. Yet the misuse of prescription drugs remains a challenge, and I think that's something we need to consider as well. And that's been alluded to by Trevor Lunn and Roy Beggs. Others have also alluded to the new developments in the use of what we call legal highs. Michaela Boyle and Roy Beggs also alluded to the relationship between the consumption of alcohol and drugs and how that relates to crime. And it has been suggested that the consumption of alcohol and the use of illicit drugs is a contributing factor in a large percentage of all crime. The misuse of both drugs and alcohol are of increasing concern to the police and public alike, and I know that members of the last Justice Committee have received briefings showing the continuing drain that substance misuse places on the justice system. Setting aside the complex issues around the misuse of and over-reliance of prescription drugs, which I know my health colleagues are addressing, can I take this opportunity to say that at the outset that the only way to minimise the harm caused by illegal drugs is just to simply not take these substances. But it's not that simple. It's easier said than done. So I do appreciate the aspect of the amendment which suggests increased awareness around the dangers of drug use and early intervention for young people, or children and young people. However, we know that people will persist in taking drugs, so we must work together to tackle the problem. My department, the Department of Health, other executive colleagues, the PSNI and a range of organisations need to work together both to intervene early, to prevent drug misuse and to effectively tackle drug misuse that is happening now. Local communities also need to play their part in working with the PSNI to help bring those who deal in this poison before the courts. This is not just my problem as Justice Minister. This is our problem in the Executive, in the Assembly, within the various agencies and in our community, and we must work together to solve it. So I do appreciate the contributions from Nicola Mallon, Michaela Boyle, Doug Beattie and others who have suggested that this is something that we need to do together. The motion put forward by Mr. Frew, Mrs. Cameron and Mr. Douglas acknowledges the impact of illegal drug misuse in Northern Ireland and calls on my department to work alongside relevant bodies to bring forward further measures to raise awareness and to ensure that the criminal justice system is tough enough to deal robustly with those who are responsible for the menace of drugs in our street. Further, the amendments put forward by Ms. Mallon and Mr. McGrath further emphasises the role of joint working, calling for the Executive to work collaboratively alongside the relevant bodies to bring forward further measures to raise awareness about the dangers of drug use, to increase investment in and awareness and access to early intervention services for children and young people as well as adults. I hope, Deputy Speaker, in the time allotted to outline how my department has been working alongside relevant bodies and give my commitment to continue to keep the issue of tackling drugs and also alcohol misuse front and centre in the criminal justice system. I hope to acknowledge the role that a wide range of bodies have in addressing this issue and highlight the productive joint working that has taken place to date and will continue to do so as we move forward in my watch. I also hope to show that by some of the innovative thinking around problem-solving justice that has already started, ably supported by the Justice Committee, that we are on a collaborative working theme and we're taking it to the next level. The Community Safety Strategy, which my department leads on, recognises the fact that the partnership working is essential if sustainable solutions are to be developed. The strand of the strategy that focuses on alcohol and drugs draws heavily on the new strategic direction for alcohol and drugs, which is led by the Department of Health and which is now in its second phase. The overall aim of the new strategic direction for alcohol and drugs, phase two, is to reduce the level of alcohol and drug-related harm in Northern Ireland. It commits government in a joined-up, cross-departmental and cross-sectoral way to prevent and address harm related to alcohol and drugs. New Strategic Direction Phase 2 seeks to direct action across five pillars: prevention and early intervention, harm reduction, treatment and support, law and criminal justice, and monitoring, evaluation and research. The Department of Justice continues to be a major contributor to the outcomes defined in the new strategic direction and chairs an alcohol and drug delivery group to take forward the law and criminal justice actions. Partners on this group include a range of executive departments and criminal justice agencies. This is a good example of the benefits of collaborative working and what we are trying to achieve through the new outcomes-based programme for government, acknowledging the role that a range of organisations have to play in tackling the complex problem of drugs misuse. Deputy Speaker, the new strategic direction includes a number of key priority areas and key indicators for the justice system, which include alcohol and drug-related crime, drug and drink driving, the number of criminal gangs dismantled, disrupted or frustrated, and increasing public confidence that drug-related problems are being addressed. Delivery of these indicators is embedded in the Community Safety Strategy, and in March this year, my department gave an update to the Justice Committee on all eight strands of the Community Safety Strategy, including on alcohol and drugs, and reported on. The level of drugs arrests has gone up by 4.3%. It was 2,831 in 2014-15, and that figure now stands at 2,953 in 2015-16. In my own constituency, the number of drugs arrests has gone up by 5.6%. The increasing number of drug seizures year on the number of drug seizures year on year has increased since 2009-10. With the figure currently standing at 5,597, which is an increase of 9.7%, and on the 14-15 figure of 5,104. The increasing number of drug seizure incidents, which has increased year on year, and in 15-16 reached the highest level seen in the past 10 years, 5,597. Work being done by the Organised Crime Task Force forced to make significant interventions against organised crime gangs, with 28 dismantled in 15-16, 42 disrupted and 54 frustrated over the same period. Confidence in the work being done to tackle alcohol and or drug-related issues in Northern Ireland, with results showing over 72% respondents having confidence in the work being done by the PSNI and over 83% having confidence being done by the local policing and community safety and partnerships. And I will talk about their work later on in my contribution. The report to the committee also highlighted some of the good work being taken forward by my department, working in partnership with others to underpin these results. For example, information about the health-led drug and alcohol monitoring information system was shared among key criminal justice networks, including the PCSPs, who were encouraged to work closely with the newly established Drugs and Alcohol Coordination Team Connection Service in both planning and delivery of any alcohol and drug-related actions, activities or projects over the next three-year period. The amendment brought forward by Ms. Mallon and Mr. McGrath calls for an increase in awareness of and access to services, including those that intervene early. The Connection Service will facilitate this via developing local events and initiatives, delivering targeted awareness-raising sessions, offering advice and support to local stakeholder networks and communities of interest, supporting a local drug and alcohol service providers network, as well as promoting and signposting to local support services. Many have talked about influence of the community and voluntary sector in tackling with this, and delivery of this work certainly, in my opinion, would rely heavily on the community and voluntary sector partners. Some have talked about the Hope Centre in Ballymena, Railway Street. Lord Morrow has said, "I've had an education. If I go down to Dungannon, well, I must be the most educated person in recent weeks because I seem to have been there a lot." And others have mentioned their own community and voluntary groups within their constituents. And so it's something, you know, previous to my new position that I've advocated for as well. So I do certainly see value in that. It is envisaged that the principal benefit of this type of engagement will be continued development of more jointly planned, delivered and coordinated initiatives in the years ahead. From the criminal justice perspective, there are a range of actions being taken forward to combat drugs misuse and to intervene at a critical point to prevent individuals from being drawn further into drug taking. In terms of young people, who are referred to the Youth Justice Agency, either to Youth Justice Services or to Woodlands Juvenile Justice Centre, all are assessed to identify any drug and alcohol related issues directly linked to offending behaviour or whether issues carry the risk of harm or self to others. Interventions which consider each individual are employed to tackle such problems in addition to group work and referral to specialised services within the community. With the introduction of youth engagement clinics, young people on the fringes of the criminal justice system are now captured in the cohort of young people with drug-related issues and can therefore be offered support and helped at an earlier stage. In terms of the work of the Probation Board, they have revised their substance programme in partnership with the Public Health Agency, and ASSERT has trained all their frontline staff in the use of screening and the delivery of brief intervention tools to address substance misuse among offenders under probation supervision. Within the prison environment, a real and concerted effort is being made to address substance misuse based around a three-strand approach: to restrict supply, to reduce demand, and to assist recovery. The Northern Ireland Prison Service, working together with partners such as the PSNI, the South Eastern Health and Social Care Trust, and others, offers drug counselling services and has diverted significant resources to this problem. Programmes are in place in all three establishments to assist and support those individuals who decide to maintain a drug-free lifestyle. And finally, my department has over recent months been working with the Home Office and a range of agencies in Northern Ireland, including local councils, the PSNI, Forensic Science Northern Ireland, courts and others, to prepare for the commencement of the Psychoactive Substances Act, which came into effect a few weeks ago. And I know that's been mentioned by some members, such as Sydney Anderson, psychoactive substances, otherwise known as legal highs. My officials work with the Department of Health and Public Health Agency officials, as well as the PSNI, to develop a pack of material about the new legislation, what it will mean for those who sell substances, as well on the harms of psychoactive substances. This was distributed across the justice system, including to the PCSPs. Public health agencies and health officials undertook a similar exercise with their networks. Another example, Deputy Speaker, of the cross-executive collaborative working that I have already seen much evidence of in my short time as Justice Minister. To come back to our local initiatives, PCSPs continue to deliver a range of initiatives aimed at addressing drug and alcohol issues, including education and awareness programmes, which can include counselling elements for those requiring assistance with drug or alcohol dependency issues. PCSP action plans will continue to focus on working collaboratively with others who reach out to young people and develop activities and programmes that will encourage them to desist from taking illicit substances. Some members may be familiar with the Drug Dealers Don't Care media campaign, which originally launched in February 2014 is now in its third year, with plans being made for another campaign at the end of this year or early 2017. This is a Northern Ireland media-wide campaign run in conjunction with Crime Stoppers, PCSPs, the Policing Board and the PSNI. The campaigns have had good levels of reported success and typically run for a number of weeks across Northern Ireland, utilising billboard, bus, radio and TV advertising, as well as social media to deliver messages to target certain demographics. In my own constituency, I know there is much work being done by the PCSP, which covers the Corian area, including delivery of the Drug Dealers Don't Care campaign, as already mentioned, as well as delivery of a parental awareness campaign around the purchase of drugs online by local young people. From the health perspective, I understand that the Public Health Agency funds one-stop shops for children and young people across Northern Ireland. These provide diversionary activities, but also education, information and support for children and young people affected by substance misuse, but also addressing broader issues such as suicide and self-harm, mental health, well-being, sexual health, relationship issues, resilience and coping skills.
Can I ask the Minister to bring her remarks to a conclusion?
Sure. Not more to say, but anyway. Just in conclusion, Mr Deputy Speaker, I hope I've shown the members the breadth and depth of the work that is being done across my department in conjunction with others across the Executive to tackle the issues of drugs misuse. I thank their members for their attention. I thank them for raising the issue and adding a new perspective onto what's something that I'm confident my department will take forward. Thank you very much.
Mr Colin McGrath to wind on the amendment. And as this is Mr McGrath's first opportunity to speak as a private member, I remind the House that it is a convention that a maiden speech is made without interruption. Mr McGrath.
Thank you for calling me, Deputy Speaker, for this, my maiden speech. It's an honour to serve one's constituents in a place such as this, and to be doing so with winding up in a debate about illegal drug use in our society and trying... I don't think we've quite got to that bit yet. Okay. In the matter of illegal drug use in our society and trying to protect our communities is both relevant and pertinent. I hail, Mr Speaker, for those that don't know me, from Downpatrick. It's the county town of Down and the final resting place and true home of St Patrick. And I say that because I know that no Armagh City representatives can interrupt me during my maiden speech. So I'll say it again. I'm from Downpatrick, which is St Patrick's true homeland. I arrive here to this seat in the footsteps of some political greats. Mr Eddie McGrady was the quiet giant of Northern Irish politics. Fair, determined and yet well-liked on all sides of this House and others, he was a gentleman, a mentor, and he is sadly missed from politics and indeed from our area. I follow too into the seat of Margaret Ritchie. Margaret has assisted and helped me in my political career, been the friendly guide for establishing me and the one with such drive and determination that we always have to work the extra hour and walk the extra mile and wrap the extra door before we get the rest. And I pay full respects to Mr Deputy Speaker, to Sean Rogers, another quiet gentleman of Irish politics. He will be missed from the front line and leaves a legacy for me to fill of hard work, service and care for the community that he served, and I pledge to maintain and deliver on the work that he started. The area I represent, Mr Deputy Speaker, is a beautiful place, stretching as it does from the shores of Strangford Loch, past where the mountains of Mourne sweep down to the sea and the idyllic expanse of Carlingford Loch. But if there's one thing that's better than the scenery in our area, it is the people of South Down. They're a wonderful, caring and friendly people, and it is my pleasure to represent them in this place and to do all I can for them in the constituency. But so, Mr Deputy Speaker, to the hand, the issue at hand, that of the scourge of illegal drugs. We offered an amendment because we felt that the original didn't go far enough. We worried that it might have focused too much on punishment, and whilst a clear message must be sent to drug dealers and those that peddle the supply chain, we feel that the motion could have gone further and called for that joined up and coordinated approach to help prevent those that feel tempted to partake in drugs. I am currently finishing my role as a youth worker, and I know too well the impact that drugs can have on young people, that be they involved in taking drugs or watching a family member do so. Focusing on young people, they can become consumed by the drug culture, the places they hang out, the people that they meet and the activities that they do. Young people might have the freedom of a new wage packet or a university place and become users, maybe first on soft drugs, but as has been mentioned, maybe moving on to harder drugs. And we do have young people that yet recreationally use harder drugs, their weekend incomplete without a dabble. And with 86% of those convicted of drug-related crimes being male, and well over 26% of convictions coming from the 18 to 24 age bracket, we are specifically letting down young men if we approach this with simply a punitive manner. There is never a happy ending to taking drugs, and it impacts young people's lives and futures and can have a debilitating impact upon them for the rest of their lives. We call for more information, more assistance for emergency help when needed, and guidance and support should people stray into drug taking and want to put the brakes on. We have asked for an executive-wide approach because whilst the Department of Justice can lock people up, the Department of Education can teach people and the Department of Health can help people when there is nobody else to support them. We must educate our children firstly as well about themselves to help them understand the reasons for the decisions that they take. With care and construction of appropriate training resources and a suitably motivated and driven team of professionals, we could target this type of education to the places it is needed most and prevent the next generation of drug users.
Will the member give away?
Sure.
Yep. Is there a role for local councils in the solution to the drug problem?
Thank you. Yes, indeed there is, and I think it has been mentioned a few times today that the policing and community safety partnerships can definitely utilise their experience on the ground in communities to be able to identify problems and to target the resources that can come from the centre. Nothing, Mr Deputy Speaker, wipes out a supply chain quicker than diminishing demand. So, in conclusion, I would say that in winding up for this motion, we have today something that we may not get a lot of in the mandate of this House, which is agreement right across from all sides. So I don't intend to go through bit by bit what people have said. I think we all know that we support the motion, we support the amendment that's there, and that we are asking Northern Ireland to be tough whenever it has to be, but caring whenever it needs to be, and sensible to know the difference and to educate people of the risks to them and allow them to make truly informed decisions. I am therefore happy to wind up on this motion.
I'm Cameron to wind up the debate on the motion.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Chair. And can I congratulate yourself on your new role in the Speaker's Chair, and also congratulations to the Justice Minister for her what I think will probably be a challenging but a very vital role within this Assembly. So I congratulate her again on that. It's very apparent that no one in this House disagrees with the intent of this motion. Not surprising given the seemingly never-ending cycle of drug-related tragedies which afflict our communities on a daily basis. Before I go on to make some points in relation to the overall strategy of the Department and the broader criminal justice family, I would of course want to convey my sympathies to all those families who have been affected by drug-related issues. I hope that by highlighting some issues in this debate, those families will be reassured that this Assembly is serious in its attentions to look at how awareness can be raised and how more support can be offered by way of intervention. I'd like to approach the debate from that perspective and trust that members from other committees may be able to highlight some issues of their own areas of interest and expertise in relation to health and the communities in particular. I would like to look at just a couple of issues which I think are worth observing in terms of overall approach of government towards drug-related crime. I was interested to note some of the statistical research in the briefing pack provided for this debate, which would seem to indicate that in terms of cases going through the court system, that the majority of these cases relate to motoring offences. And I would also perhaps suggest that in terms of government spend and public awareness, that spend since devolution on motoring-related schemes, such as speed awareness, is probably higher than most other types of campaigns. So whilst I'm somewhat reluctant to base my argument on statistics alone, the broad point I am making is that perhaps it is time for the government to look again at its priorities in awareness, given the continued volume of motoring-related incidents going through the courts. A secondary point in relation to this area is that perhaps in terms of motoring in the courts, there are some who might think that the ordinary motorist is already subject to enough forms of scrutiny and penalty opportunities where even the most basic mistake by a driver leaves them facing immediate financial and possible criminal penalties. I make this point again because in the briefing pack the surveys would indicate that the vast majority of people would prefer that the resources of the police and courts would be better spent in dealing with the antisocial behaviour and criminality often fuelled by drugs or the need to finance the supply of drugs, rather than putting thousands of motorists through courts for what may be deemed minor offences in the overall scheme of things. Of course, that in no way minimises those motoring offences, which are indeed truly shocking in nature, and no one would seek to minimise the impact of those instances either. But I do want to take I do want to make the broad point that the criminal justice system must continually examine its priorities to ensure they are in line with what the public want to see in terms of proper social justice for those who find themselves victims of criminality. And it is important the public have confidence in that system, and my fear is that the public who are shown a zero tolerance for minor parking or bus lane misdemeanours are then told by the same criminal justice system that there's nothing to be done for the victims left, victims of theft or criminal damage to their property, resulting in a greater sense of injustice and a further loss of confidence in the police. I also believe that this sense of injustice in communities is further highlighted between the obvious link between drug-related crime and paramilitarism. A further sense, if you like, of rules for one and rules for another, for the thousands of decent law-abiding citizens, whilst the paramilitary organisations appear to rule communities without fear of interference from any aspect of the criminal justice system. Northern Ireland seems to be perhaps more gripped by paramilitarism and their never-ending criminal empires than ever before, and every person in every community knows who the leaders, the dealers and the suppliers are. I do accept that people are reluctant to name names, but that in itself cannot be an excuse for a lack of police action in tackling this scourge once and for all. The longer we accept the status quo, then the more we condemn our young people to remain trapped in these unholy environments where drugs are a currency and criminality is a character reference. In closing my remarks, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I'm looking forward to the Justice Committee being able to look into these areas in much more depth and to be able to scrutinise the various organisations and strategies who are responsible for ensuring that drugs and the misery they cause can be given the highest possible priority. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I'm going to turn now to the comments from other members within this debate, and I certainly, as one of the named partners on this motion, I'm very pleased to see the united force behind this motion today and indeed the amendment, and fully support the amendment also. It's a good day when you see this Assembly agreeing across the board on such a vital subject. So we had Paul Frew, who was the proposer of the motion, and he stated that it was an important debate, and he talked about the devastation that drugs have in society and amongst families. He was supportive of the amendment and the holistic approach that offered. Talked about drugs being illegal but also addictive, the need to tackle these at the top of the drug drug dealing, whether that's paramilitaries or not. He talked about drugs being endemic in our society, even in prison. He mentioned that £73,000 is the cost to keep someone in prison for a year, and spoke of all the other crimes connected to drug crime. And in particular, he invited the Minister to visit Railway Street Addiction Service, and he also mentioned the Hope Centre in Ballymena and spoke of the valuable supportive work that they do, and also about the fight not to reduce the funding in this specialised unit. Next we had Nicola Mallon from the SDLP, and she moved the amendment. She spoke of the issue. She said it was grave concern to her constituents in North Belfast, and that she had witnessed the difficulties families are suffering, the painful battle and the anguish of drug addiction. She commended the DUP for bringing forward the motion on illegal drugs, and also said that the Minister had a key role to play and that more needed to be done by the PSNI and Justice Department. She spoke of the misuse of prescription drugs and the need for health and education to have a greater role. She praised those in the statutory and community and voluntary sector, and also spoke of the referrals to CAMHS and that pressure. She spoke of the drugs misuse, the immense cost, human and financial, also about mental health and well-being. And she shared a testimonial of Aaron Fox, and I hope I've got the name right, and the call from his parents to act on this subject. Next we had Michaela Boyle from Sinn Féin. She spoke about the scourge in society of illegal drugs, as young people were abusing alcohol, and talked about the crime, domestic violence and rape that was associated with that abuse. She spoke of early intervention and awareness being key, that proper help in prisons was needed. She spoke about some crime figures from Strabane District Council having increased in 2014-15, and that drugs possessions recorded was up, and she welcomed the increase in arrests. She said that more collaborative working was needed and that the public needed to needed confidence in the justice system, especially for those who felt down by the courtroom. Mr. Doug Beattie from the UP was fully supportive of the motion and the amendment, and spoke about the focus on prevention, the need to involve all ministers to deal with the issues, the problem with illegal drugs, socially acceptable to take drugs, how that is today, and he also spoke of his own experience of the cannabis fields in Asia, and mentioned that he thought we would be better off in Europe to tackle the drugs issue. Trevor Lunn from the Alliance Party supported the motion and amendment and preferred the wording of the amendment. He spoke about cross-departmental issues and in particular education. Mentioned that prescription drugs being a bigger part of the problem, and also mentioned paramilitary groupings and criminal gangs and their responsibility for those illegal drugs. Lord Moore from the DUP commended the House who brought the motion and welcomed the agreement across the benches. He wished the Justice Minister well in her role and spoke about cases coming to the courts in Fermanagh, South Tyrone, and the use of cannabis, which he said was a gateway to other drug usage. He talked about the drugs having potential to impact negatively on the body. And also spoke of a pilot scheme called Breakthrough within Dungannon, I think. And I think he also invited the Minister out to visit that programme. So, moving on, there are other contributors. Dahi Mackay from Sinn Féin supported as well, as did Sydney Anderson of the DUP. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Chair, and Roy Beggs from UP, and finally with George Robinson. So just in finishing, again, to thank the members from across the chamber for their support for this important motion. Thank you.
Question is that the amendment standing on the marshal list be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. Thank you.